Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Good morning, everyone. Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning on this beautiful, I would say, lovely day, but a little humid out there. Michael and I were walking in, and my brother lives in the panhandle in Florida near Pensacola. And I was like, man, it would be gorgeous if it wasn't so humid. And we looked at each other and we're like, it's like we're in Florida, but we don't live in Florida for a reason. Anyway, so this morning, I don't even remember where I heard it. I think it was just, it was either in prayer or in worship this morning. And, or a song I heard during whatever this morning. But let us trust you, Lord, without boundaries. Does our trust in the Lord have limits? Do we trust the Lord for some things and not for others? Because we should trust the Lord in everything.
Exactly,
yeah. And there are areas of our life where it's just how we do. It's just how we live life. We trust him for things. But then there's other areas where like it takes a lot more for us to just trust and let go. Because there's some things that are so easy for us to manipulate and control. There's some things that's so easy for us to just do it, right? Because we're just a do-it generation. But the Lord wants us to trust him in everything. He can truly bless everything that we will let go and give to him. And so I just want to read some scriptures to encourage us this morning. Jeremiah 17, verses 7 through 8 says, "Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when heat cometh, but her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit." Now, I don't know if you've looked around this year, but it doesn't look so pretty in some places. I know we were at Adventureland yesterday for Michael's picnic, and there were dead vines everywhere, dead trees everywhere, dead shrubbery everywhere. And I was maybe a little judgmental towards the groundskeeper there. But, I mean, when there's no rain, and you mow, and there's no rain, and if you don't want to water and pay to irrigate your grass turns brown, and if it's not taken care of. But are we trying to take care of it, or are we trusting the Lord to take care of the things in our life? Because when we trust him, we're hooked up to the source.
Yes.
Our roots go deep. His roots go deep. All we need to do is connect to him, and his roots go deep and provide us everything that we need. In Proverbs, I'm going the wrong way here. Here we go. Proverbs chapter 3. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not into thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, then he shall direct thy path. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be the health to thy navel and marrow to thy bones. Isaiah 43, verses 1 through 3. But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name, thou art mine. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon you. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Seba for thee. And Psalm 143, verse 8. Cause me to hear thy loving kindness in the morning, for in thee do I trust. Cause me to know the way wherein I should walk, for I lift up my soul unto thee. There's something special that happens when we start our day with the Lord. It sets the whole tone for the day. It sets our perspective for the day. And it puts our hearts and our minds at perfect peace. Now, that peace can be stolen very quickly as soon as we leave the house, or sometimes before we leave the house. But it's the perfect place to start as a reminder for ourselves. Because in the end of the day, God wants he wants us to make him our habitation.
Mm-hmm.
He wants us to make him our dwelling place. He wants us to make him our source for all things, for wisdom, for favor. You know, I mean, Michael and I joke a lot about, you know, the blessings. You know, if we're aware, they're all around us.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You know, getting a shaded spot to park at Adventureland is a blessing.
Yes.
There's only like 20 of them.
Yeah.
So it's just little things, right?
Yes.
That the Lord reminds us, I've got this, and
yes.
I'm with you.
Yes.
And my favorite psalm, and it's the soldier psalm, which, you know, is special. I know to my husband, too. Psalm 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings that shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou shalt dash your foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample underfoot. Because He hath set His love upon thee, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Let us make the Lord our habitation. Let us make Him our dwelling place. And from there flows everything. Love and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name.
In
Jesus' name. Any prayer requests or testimonies this morning? Anyone have anything they'd like to share? Or yeah, Mike.
I lifted up Myron. I've done a lot of pain again this morning. Prayed for him Wednesday night. So we need for that healing to manifest. For Cindy also, she was had a rough night with leaving in her total healing too. Her doctor she went to last Thursday said she's doing amazing, considering the symptoms that they originally thrown at her. So naturally, we're rising above those symptoms that they're declaring and declaring her healing in the name of the Lord.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen. Myron and Cindy is from the, yeah, Tim.
Yes, I'm going to ask prayer for our neighbors. Just that sometimes you see people that are struggling with a lot of things, you know, and you know your heart goes out to them, and they just would turn things over to the Lord. How much better things would be, their life would be. So we ask prayer for them. And also just want to thank God for all the blessings that He gives throughout the day. And you know, there's so many times that I teach, you know, sometimes you have an opportunity just to get alone with a student, and then they kind of share different things in their life, and that can touch both of you, because they feel like they can trust you, what you're going to say, and then you can get down inside of them and say, you know, because sometimes they want you to pray for a certain situation or something going on, and I say, it's all right, I'd like to pray for you, because I always think prayer is such a privilege and an honor to be able to pray and take that request to God, and then you see that change in their life or change in their family's life. So I just want to thank the Lord for that opportunity. Yes.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, Jane.
I don't know these people personally, but our daughter had a young man that worked for her, and he and his wife were in an accident a week ago, and he was killed outright, 39, and his wife is in a coma, still in a coma. Mm-hmm. His funeral was yesterday. Oh. They leave behind three children, and his sister is the only one that could take the children, and she has six of her own.
Oh my goodness.
So we need to pray for this family that mother will be healed.
Amen.
And she'll rise up to be able to take care of their children.
Amen.
That family needs desperate prayer.
Amen.
Amen. Yes, Lord. Yes, you know their name, their situation, Lord. Anyone else this morning? All right. Well, let's stand and go to the Lord this morning. Heavenly Father, we just come before you right now, Lord. We lift this family up to you, Lord, that you raise that mother up, that you open her eyes, Lord, that she would be well, Lord. And whole, Lord, to rise up and take care of her family, Lord, that you minister in that situation, Lord. To touch the sister, Lord. Touch the children, Lord, who are so afraid, Lord. That you have your way in that situation, Lord. I ask you to touch Cindy this morning, Myron this morning, Lord, with your healing touch, Lord. We thank you. Thank you. Thank you. By the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, Lord, that we are saved. Pastor, revelation, Lord, to guide us and lead us in your word, to blaze a trail where none have gone before, to reveal the hidden mysteries of your word to us, and let this body come together in fullness, Lord. Let this body come together, be knit together, perfectly formed to perform what you have called this body, abundant life, to do. There are those members of this body who have not yet heard or responded to the call, Lord. Let them have ears to hear. Let them have eyes to see and draw them in by your Spirit, Lord, as we lift you high. And you receive all the glory. That you receive all the glory. In the name above every name. Name of the one true God, creator of heaven and earth. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Lord. Jesus. Jesus, we love you. We trust you, Lord. Come and have your way this day in this service. In Jesus' name. Amen. Just a reminder, if you have your cell phones with you, to silence them or turn them off. And let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Toby and Don, would you two like to come take the offering this morning, please? Toby, you want to ask a blessing, please?
Lord, we're thankful to be here today, God. Let's give you glory and praises for your
Thank
word.
You, Lord.
God, we will sing praises to your name, Lord. We will expound your word today, God, and we will be touched by you. Now, Lord, we just ask that you will send each and every one of us out this week with your message,
yes,
God.
Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We are your vehicles, God. That all we have to do is to speak you,
yes.
And you will take over.
Yes.
You will move because
yes.
Your word is worthy.
Yes,
yes.
Lord.
All we have to do is open the door,
yes,
and
Lord.
You'll take it from there, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes.
God, we are your vehicles,
yes.
God, just to deliver you to
yes.
This world.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
We praise and glorify you for it.
Yes, Lord.
Now, God, we just ask that you'll bless this offering, God. Bless the gift and the giver. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Will you rise? Will you rise? Hallelujah. You can be seated, please. Oh, we want to thank the Lord because the Lord is here. Whether it's two or three touching or agreeing, he'd be in the midst. And we thank you. Thank you for the worship team. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening. We just got a great worship team. At a church when I lived down in Fort Madison, I was part of the worship team. And one thing that the lady that ran it, we came on Saturdays in practice, and she said, y'all be serious about it. Y'all come here, and you're setting a tone for the worship of the service. You be serious. And she was serious. Because she come to your house and see if you were living what you were singing. And she said, if you're not living, you don't need to be up there. Sometimes you need to sit down and take care of some things you have at home. Because that worship, you're worshiping the most holy God. How powerful is that? To be able to worship God, I'm just awed by that. Have the opportunity to worship God and praise God. One of the things that I love that last song. It's about making a decision. And the question is offered God. Will you ride? Are you willing to go all the way? Are you willing to be totally committed to God? You remember where Moses had heard all this noise down in the bottom of the camp, and he was up getting the word of God and come down there, and he said they turned aside. They end up making the gold calf. You know that whole episode. And it sounded like war in the camp. And that's what it was. They was rebelling against God. They didn't need to have a calf to lead them back. They wanted to go back to Egypt. I don't know what happened to old Mo. He's probably long gone. Yeah. We need somebody to lead us back. We need a God we can see when he already told them to not make any other gods. Yeah. And Moses was not happy. He came down there and he said this. I love it. Who's on the Lord's side? Mm-hmm. I love that. Who's on the Lord's side? And we look at Elijah basically did the same thing to the prophets of Baal. How long halt y'all between two opinions? If God be God, serve him. Baal be Baal, serve him. The one who answers by fire, let him be God. And that's really where we're at today. Who is on the Lord's side? Who's willing to really give it all? You know, when Isaiah was asked, you know, who's going to go for me? You know, send me. I'm willing to go. And that's where we're at in our lives. I really believe we come to that point, but we don't have to go alone. That's it. Because God is working with you. That's one thing when Jesus said, come follow me. I love that term. Follow means he's walking in front. And all we have to do is follow him and act like him. Now, I'm telling you, I've been around long enough. Sometimes it's hard to act like Jesus when there's a lot of stuff going on. Sometimes you want to act like the old person. You know, and the thing has come, we have a new life in Christ. And what he's always doing, I love God, he's always working from the inside out. You know, think about where you used to be. One thing I remember, I just sometimes, you know, you kind of reflect on where you were. And there's nothing wrong with that. Just don't stay there. Just don't stay there. Some people get lost in their past. One of the things my brother said years ago, I wrote this down because I always keep it. He said, either bury the past or the past will bury you. I thought, wow, that's good. Because some people live in yesterday. But, you know, God's here to do a new thing. God's here to say, where are those people that want to trust me fully? Where are those people? Let's turn to Psalms 56. We're going to look at Psalm 56. This is one of my favorite psalms because there's so much in the Psalms, because if you look at David's life, the thing about David, like everybody else, David had his ups and downs. You know, there's times he was crying. And, you know, and one thing that struck me about tears, there's times in our life, and I went through some things back in 2002, I think was probably the biggest change in my life. Sometimes when you have a relationship issue, and this is long before I moved up here, And God bless him with somebody wonderful now, so we're good. But at that time, when everything's kind of collapses on you, and everything falls apart, and you think, man, what happened? Where is God in all of it? Well, the one thing that got me through, I was watching a TV program, and what got me through was actually Psalm 56. And I'm gonna just start here in verse 8. You say, "You number and record my wanderings, put my tears into your bottle, are they not in your book?" That is just so tender. Are, you know, tears in a bottle? And actually, they actually used to do that in the old days. They actually used to do that, go out, and they talk about it, that they used to go, and when a person was ill or a person was in great distress, his friend would go and see him, and they'd actually take a bottle, and they'd scoop some of the tears up, and they'd keep them so that person could remember where they was at that time. It was almost like they just kept it, say, "Hey, you remember this bottle? You remember where you were at this time?" And the tears are so precious to them, they want to keep them. Now, you can imagine doing that with God, doing that to your tears. They are so important to God that he keeps them in a bottle and records them in a book. I'm just amazed that, you know, God keeps it, that he cares that much about us. And sometimes when you're going through things, it seems like, man, I'm telling you, where are you, God? You know what he's saying? I'm in the same place I was yesterday. I love that. And I know I've said that before, that I never once in all the visions I've seen of God, I always see him like Isaiah said, see him high and lifted up. That's the way I see him. I see God and all his glory and just this awe around him. I've never once had an image of God and Jesus, the Holy Spirit, running around wondering what they're going to do. I've not one time ever seen that. All I see is like when you see Jesus on the earth, when he's all, it's almost like he was crying out, "I wish they just believed me." That's all I'm asking. Because he was so amazed when people had faith. He's almost shocked. Well, this person believed in me. You know, because look, when we think about God, the Creator, and all that he's done, and he came down in the embodiment of Jesus. Jesus, every bit God, but he was man. Now you think about that. Just think about it. Because now nobody can say, "Hey, I, you know, God don't really understand, you know, because he was never a man. He don't understand, you know, how it feels to be a baby, or, you know, now he's 4, 5, 6. He don't understand." Can't say that after Jesus came. You can't say that. Because Jesus was a baby. Jesus went through those things. He went through those teenage years. He went through all those things. But you know what? He knew who sent him. That's one thing about it. He said in John, where he said, "I always do those things that please the Father." You know, he was always here to do his Father's will. Isn't that something? When he was 12 years old, you know, he's at the temple. And you know, when you travel in a big group and your cousins and relatives, you kind of think, you know, when we leave, everybody's kind of together. They're in a group somewhere. And you know, it was a major thing traveling them days. And they realized, hey, where's Jesus at? Oh, man, we forgot Jesus, left him in the temple. Well, you know what? Some of us, we need to stop forgetting Jesus and leave him at the temple. We need to make sure he comes with us. We need to make sure that Jesus here, we don't leave him somewhere. When you go on vacation, Jesus ought to come with you. Yes. If you go to the schoolhouse, Jesus ought to come with you. When you go to work, Jesus ought to come with you. But they went back. Now, I've been a parent, and I'm going to tell you, when you have a kid gone, you know, you're not happy when they didn't get in the group. You're not happy with them. And I'm telling you, Mary and Joseph was not happy. They was not happy. When you have to turn around, it's a different than going on the interstate and going up the next exit, turn around and coming back. It was a major deal, right? But Jesus knew one thing. He was up there and he was talking with the teachers. They was amazed. They was amazed at all his learning and stuff, you know. And they came back. And I love the way Jesus responds. And, you know, because they're just parents. Joseph and Mary, just, "Son," you know, you can see the modern day, "What are you doing? What's going on? Why are you back here? Don't you know we're upset? You know, we're sorrowing after you." And Jesus, he was, you know, I saw this on a movie version, and when I first heard it, you know, it's like, you know, his response was, "Don't you know I must be about my Father's business?" Now, that wouldn't go over well with some people, because that would almost sound kind of smart, but no. Mary, I love Mary, because the Bible says she was always pondering things in her heart. Yeah. She has to realize, you know, that she always realized that this was God's son. And she had the privilege to birth him, bring him in the world. So there's something different about him versus the other kid she had later. And she just kind of pondered, and then he went back with him. But he knew he must be about his Father's business. What does that tell us? If we're going to be like Jesus, then we need to be about our Father's business, right? We need to always be about what God wants us to do. You know, and one of the reasons we don't do what God asks us to do is one of the biggest things is sometimes we're afraid what others think.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Does that stop people from doing things?
Yeah.
Oh, man, when it comes to the kingdom of God. Oh, Tim, you know, what if they think I'm crazy? That's all right.
Yeah.
You know, mad for Christ's sake. Doing crazy for Christ. It didn't matter. Who are you doing it for? We're not doing it for a picture. We're not doing it to get exposed and out. We're doing it because God asked us to do it. Because you look in the Bible, God asked them to do a lot of things.
Oh, yes.
I mean, you think about, let's be thinking about, you know, when Joshua marched around Jericho, you know? I don't know if that's a battle strategy or not. But, you know, they're marching around the city. They're not shooting, not nothing. And they're just marching around. I'm sure people are looking at, what in the world's going on here?
Yeah.
You know, what kind of strategy is this? They keep marching around.
Yeah.
But God had a strategy if they just did.
Yeah.
You know, and they shouted one day and the walls came down.
Yeah.
And that's what it takes. That's really what it takes. Whatever God asks you to do, just go ahead and do it.
Yeah.
You remember at the wedding, that's what they said. You know, they ran out of wine and they come to, you know, and went to Mary and said, hey, you know, we need some more wine to run it out of. And Mary understood that. She says, whatever he says, just do it. Whatever God asks you to do, just do it. You can't ever go wrong serving God. You can't ever go wrong. That's the thing. We look here. You number, record my wantings, put my tears in your bottle. Are they not in your book? Then shall my enemies, this verse 9, turn back in this day. I cry out, this I know. We can't forget these words. This I know, for God is for me. God is for you. Never, ever forget that. That's what keeps you going. That's what got me going in those times. Once I realized, wait a minute, God's for me. We're going to get through this. We're going to come out the other side. And then, you know, all these tears. And sometimes it's like your tears run out, but you're still crying. And it's like when you comfort a child that has some setback. And, you know, we look at what the kids get upset over, but that's big to them.
Yeah.
You know, it may not be big to other people, but it's big. We used to go out to Sunday school bus route, and I came over to this one child's house and I asked her to go to school, and they had a pet frog. You know, people have different pets. They like frogs. Well, the frog wasn't looking too good. I said, Tim, would you pray for my pet frog? Well, you know, what do? That pet frog was important to her.
Yes.
So you know what you do? You pay for the pet frog. That's what you do. You pray for him. You know, if your child falls down, pick him up. Oh, Mom, my knee. You know, skin my knee. Parents got to kiss their boo-boos because they make them feel better if you do that. But, you know, you put some Band-Aid on and you kiss it. And, you know, when I kiss, I start praying for him. I pray for him so they realize that God can heal. If they can realize that.
Yeah.
Why do you pray with your kids when you go to bed? That time is so tender to them. Usually, you know, you try to get them calmed down and everything, and we pray. So, and then it said, do you have anything you want to pray for? And it's amazing. We took care of nephews and stuff. Yeah, yes, would you pray for my mom? That's powerful coming from a kid. That is powerful. And what we have to always realize is that God hears that.
Yeah.
I love that. God hears the prayer. I've seen so many prayers answered, but them kids that would just get serious and pray for God. Just pray to God and say, I'm going to God. When we was little, when we was in church, we always had a time of testimonies. We always had that. Unless it was, you know, special day, Thanksgiving play or something, you know, a Christmas play or something. We always had that. That was always so powerful to me because there was one lady. Her name was Bertha, and she sat usually about two or three rows in the front, and it was testimony. And I'm telling you, every time we kind of would wonder who was going to be first because it was always her. I wonder if Bertha's going to be first, but I ain't kidding you. I'm just trying to be honest. It's like as soon as the testimony, so it's like somebody poked her because she'd pop up. She would just pop out of there, and she was the first one like every Sunday. And she was a quiet woman otherwise. She rode the bus, and she said this. She sat up, and she started singing this song every single time. Standing on that rock. God is my rock. Standing on that rock and never give away. She'd always start with that. And I thought, what makes her so confident about that? Now, I'm probably 6, 7 years old, but she sang it every time. Standing on that rock. She realized who was her rock in her life. She realized who was most important in her life. And that's really where we got to come to. In God, and this is verse 10 in Psalm 56. In God, I have, oh, I love it. In God, whose word I praise, in the Lord, whose word I praise, verse 11, in God have I put my trust, confident reliance. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, man, your vows are upon me, O God. I render praise to you and give you thank offerings. For you have delivered my life from death, yes, and my feet from failing, that I might walk before God in the light of light and of the living. How powerful is that? I love when you get to that point, like David said, says, I will. I love that because that's saying you will. I will not be afraid. I love that. And he says, you know, I will render praise to you. I choose to do that. That's one thing that God did with us. He gave us a choice, right? And I love that. He gave us a free will, a choice to choose to serve him or not. And I tell you what, we was talking about yesterday, it was out riding. One thing about it is that God gives you so much when you choose to serve him, because he gives you things that have nothing to do. He can bless you financially, but he gives you things higher than that, such as peace. He gives you peace that the world don't understand. Tell you what, some people would rather have that than silver or gold. Sometimes that's all they need, is to have peace in their life, that tranquility, you know. And some people, they need to have different things moving in their life. And so they got these situations that create turmoil. Like Suzanne was saying, you know, it says, you know, give me that peace and that time in the morning. And sometimes before you get out the door, there's a lot of things stirred up. But I can keep claiming that peace. That God, you're going to go before me. I noticed it in the classes that I teach. I didn't do it when I first started, but later on, what I would do is I go in that classroom and I start praying over that classroom. And I said, God, this is your classroom. That's what it is. You give me the opportunity, and I start doing it. Praying over cars, praying over kids, praying over. You know, it's amazing when you invoke God, you bring him in the midst of it. How the just situation changes. That's what God wants us to do. That's what he really wants us to do. Because one of my favorite scriptures is found in Esther chapter 4, verse 14. I love that. That's one of my favorite, because that was the chapter when, we're going to get, there it is. Thank you. This is one of my favorite times. We know Esther and the Jews and Mordecai, and we know the whole situation. We read that story. But we can relate it today, okay? For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance rise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. And who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this? Did you ever wonder why you were born in this time?
Yeah.
Right? You ever wonder that?
Yeah.
Right? Because you could be born in the 1800s, right? You could be born in 1600, you know, 1500. You know, might have been Shakespeare back there. I don't know who you talked to. You know, I mean, you could have been born in another generation. But why are you born right now? Because God has a purpose for you.
Yes.
He always has a plan for you. You know, and the thing that I love about that is when you look at Jeremiah 29:11, if you put that in up, I always love that scripture. Because before you was formed in your mom's belly, before the generations back, before human beings were even created, God already was working on this part, right? For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you an expected end. And one verse says, give you a future and a hope. That's what God is going to do for you. He's got plans for your life. He doesn't, you know, we was just thinking about the other day, all the people in prison, all the people, you know, involved in a lot of other stuff. I remember saying this. I was going down 14 in a big truck, Southeast 14, about 10 o'clock in the morning. And here was this young man. He looked like he's probably maybe 30s, and he didn't have a shirt on, and he was stumbling. You can tell he was drunk or doped out or something, but he kept stumbling, and I'm watching him, and he was just one step away from stepping on 14th Road. I mean, if he would come off that, you know, all them trucks would run up down through there. And I remember, and I know I shouldn't get so animated, but I do. I can't hold it back. When it's built up, but Jeremiah, has it, shut up on your bones. It's like fire.
Yeah.
You know, it's gotta come out of you, you know? And I remember yelling. I remember saying, no. That's not the plan for that man's life. It's not what God has for him to stumble on this road. God's got something better for him. And I remember, you know, just praying for him and said, you know, I'm just thinking in some circumstances or somebody give him a Bible track or somebody pray for him or somebody, but I'm saying one step and he's gone.
Yeah.
You know, and I just kept thinking that one thing about it. Psalm 57:2, it says, I will cry to God Most High, who performs on my behalf, hallelujah, and rewards me, who brings to pass his purposes for me and surely completes them. Now, is that powerful?
Right.
That's powerful. I look down at my life back in 2002, and you think, Lord, what's going on here? But one thing he was saying, Tim, I'm for you.
Yes.
All you need to do is keep that. I say this a lot to myself. Just keep the train on the track.
Yep.
You're going to get to your destination.
Yep.
You keep on praying.
Yep.
You keep on believing.
Yes.
You never give up. Right. God already said he's never going to leave you or forsake you.
Right.
And his mercies are new every day.
Right.
He gives you another opportunity every day.
Right.
You know what? Even if you fail, one thing about it, pick you up.
Yep.
He can pick you up.
Yes.
You know, like Ali said, the problem is not being knocked down. The problem is staying down. And that's what we have to do. Get back up.
Yep.
Say, we're going again.
Yep.
God, I'm trying to learn this lesson. Don't have it yet. But I tell you what, I'm going to be better. I'm going to be better, yes, than I was today. I'm going to be better. Because you know what? I'm going to keep praying towards you.
Yep.
I'm going to keep believing you. I'm going to keep. If I got any sin, that's what David. If I got any sin in my heart, you know, what I want to do is I don't want any sin here. So I'm going to hide the word of God in there. That's what's going to make a difference. Because say, God can tell you not to do something. I know I say that a lot. But the problem we get in trouble is we don't listen.
Yeah.
We don't listen to what God has to say. God can tell you which house to get. He can tell you which car to get. He can tell you what car dealer to go. He can tell you who to be involved with. I remember I was out in the East Coast. My daughter lived out in Philadelphia. And one night I came to church, and I wasn't in a relationship then. And how did pastor know this? I don't know, except God knew. And he was talking about relationships. And one thing he said, I came on a Wednesday night, and I thought, wow, that's good. It's right where I'm at. Because God knew I was going to come on a plane. We're going to make it to church that night. And he says one thing about it. When you get in a relationship, before you get in there too, once you ask God to show that person, ask God to show you the other person's heart.
Right.
I thought, wow, how simple is that? You know, because then, and God is, you know, it's not quite a match. Because if you wait till you get in love with them, then it's hard to break it off. And the reason couples won't ask is because they don't want God to say no. But he already knows down the line what's going to happen. If you just listen to what God is saying to you, how important that is. God, you know, it's like sometimes I see, like we look at it our way, that God gives you a thumb up on something. You know, it's good. It's good. You made the right choice. But I found out if you pray first, that keeps you out of a lot of trouble. We do it just the opposite. We get in trouble, and then we ask God to clean it up.
Yeah.
You know? Now, God's gracious. I've seen him straighten some stuff out. But I'm thinking, God said, Tim, why don't we pray about it first? Why don't we seek God first? Why don't we go to the one who's all-knowing, all-seeing, that understands what's going on? Let's look at him first and say, God, should I do this or not do this? Should I move here? You know, we think about how big the city of Des Moines is. It may make a difference what side of town you live on, right? Because you're going to have neighbors on this side or that side, right? Maybe that neighbor that you think about this house right here, and they've been praying for a long time to have a godly neighbor move in beside them.
Yeah.
They might be praying. Maybe that was you.
Yeah.
I don't know. But what I'm saying is, when you trust God first, you can never go wrong.
That's right.
You can absolutely never, ever go wrong. And I want to just share one more scripture here. Because I love the Psalms. There's just so much in them. Okay? And this is Psalms 57, verse 9. Oh, man. I'd get excited up here.
Come on.
Verse 9. I got it starred in my Bible. That's how much I love it. I know we got different versions. Okay? And this is amplified. It kind of brings things, a little expands things. But I will praise and give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. And I'm going to go ahead and grab 10. For your mercy and love and kindness are great, reaching to the heavens, and your truth and faithfulness to the clouds. How big is that?
Yeah.
I mean, how big is that? His mercy and loving kindness are great. Never forget that. No matter what you're going through, remember your tears are precious. Remember that God is for you. Never forget that. Never ever forget that. You forgot it. You know, write it big across your refrigerator or put it somewhere. Never forget that. That kept staying with me, for God is for me. God is for me. You know, no matter what the circumstances may be. You know, imagine if my covers get low, or I don't have gas in the car, or I don't have this. God is for me. And he can make a way out of no way. You know, people say, Tim, which way should I go? I said, follow the way, and you can't go wrong. Like one person used to say, he said, you know what? Said Jesus hung up for all my hang-ups. That's what he used to say. And that's true. He hung up for all of us. He can provide a way. You know, we used to sing that song when we was younger. And one of the things I wrote the first verse because I just really, the first chorus in the verse, learning to lean. I remember we sang that a lot. Song, learn to lean. I'm learning to lean. Learning to lean. Learning to lean on who? Jesus. Not myself. Not men around us. I'm learning to lean on Jesus because I know he's the only one that won't let me down.
Right.
You know, friends, I like those friends that hang in there with you. But, you know, they may have circumstances. I can't help you this time, brother. I can't help you.
Yeah.
But I never went to Jesus like that. He's got a way.
Yes,
he's got a way. He said, learning to lean. I'm learning to lean, learning to lean, learning to lean on Jesus. Finding more power than I've ever dreamed.
Yeah.
Because I'm learning to lean on Jesus. That's why.
Exactly.
Hallelujah.
Right.
I'm learning to lean on Jesus. The joy I can't explain fills my heart since the day I made Jesus my King.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Look at your life before Jesus and after Jesus. Life is so much better. The smile returns, the joy is up there because I know I got a Savior that lives in my heart. I know I have a Savior that turns it around. I know we have a wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, hallelujah, that will never leave you or forsake you. He said, for I am with you always to the end of the age. Hallelujah. Psalm 37:25, I was young, but now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken or seen begging bread. Not one time. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, the joy I can't explain fills my heart since the day I made Jesus my King. His blessed Holy Spirit is leading my way.
Yes.
He's teaching, and I'm learning to lean.
Yes.
Yes.
That's what it's about. Today, let's remember that.
Yep. Yes.
That we're learning to lean on Jesus every day.
Yes.
Yes.
Just remember those, for God is for me,
yes,
and I'm learning to lean. Would y'all stand? Y'all stand. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you that you will never leave us or forsake us. We thank you that you are such a wonderful, holy God. We thank you that you're going to restore those years, hallelujah, that the cankerworm have taken. You're going to restore them. And Lord, you are a God that healeth. You are a God that can give us beauty for ashes. You can heal the brokenhearted. You are the God that healeth. Those that come forth today, we thank you for the opportunity to be able to pray for them. You are a wonderful, wonderful God. And one thing about it, it's all about in the beginning God. That's where it started.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That God, without you, where would we be? And God, we just ask you, each one of us, the Bible says you love us with an everlasting love. We ask you to go ahead and put your arms around each and every one here today. Whatever the needs that they have, we ask you to meet every one of these needs. Lord, we ask you in your wonderful holy name to allow them to inside to just have that light of yours just burst out. And Lord, let the decision always be to serve you, no matter what.
Yes,
hallelujah. Whether my friends go, I'm going with them.
Right.
Hallelujah. Whether or not my cousins go or whoever may go, but we choose, as the song said, we choose to ride with you.
Yes,
we choose who's on the Lord's side. We are on your side.
Yes.
That's what. And we're not going to be double-minded. We're not going to do that. Hallelujah. We are going to say, we're not going to have two opinions. We've made up our mind, and our mind is to serve you.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We choose to walk in the light.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. We choose
yes,
to love today.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. We choose to keep believing you, no matter if all the circumstances look like there's no way that we can make it out.
Yes.
But one thing we know, that you brought us out before. And we know that you're going to bring us out again.
Yes.
We ask you, Lord, just to keep raining down. Just rain that fire.
Yes.
Lord, just give us a more enthusiastic heart for you every day.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Let us have a love for our neighbor.
Yes.
Let us realize when you ask us to do something, we are going to just not hesitate.
Yes, Lord.
We are going to gravitate to
yes.
what you say.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. And Father God, let the word, when we take time to study our word, let that word get
yes.
deep down inside of us.
Yes.
Let that word just ruminate. Let that word change us and realize it's all about your word, Lord. Because
yes.
you are the word. Lord, just give everyone peace. Lord, give them a love and an understanding. And realize there's a lot of people out there that need to hear the word. There's a lot of people out there that are hurting. And one thing that they need is you.
Yes.
Oh, Father God, let's just take these last few minutes and praise God. So everybody, let's just praise God for a few more minutes.
Lord.
Let's just praise him. Let's just lift
Lord.
Him up. Hallelujah.
Lord.
Let's give him the glory. Shout out to the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. We're going to ride with you. We made that decision. Hallelujah. Father God, because you were willing to die for us, surely, surely we can live for you. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you for all the blessings you've given us. The Bible said, I will bless the Lord at all times. At all times, his praise shall continually be in my mouth. And that's what's going to happen. Lord, let us stop complaining and start proclaiming your goodness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, it's all about you, God. As John the Baptist said, I must decrease so you can increase. So people can see that we have spent time with you. That there's something different. As Moses came down, he had to put veil on his face because he's shown so much. Spending time with you. And Father God, let people see a difference. A difference in us every day. Why are you glowing? Why are you so happy? I can say, because I know my Redeemer lives.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I knows who I belong to.
Yes.
As Paul said, I want to know him. Lord, let us know him in a richer, deeper way.
Yes.
Let us be changed from day to day, from glory to glory. It's all about you. Hallelujah. I look toward the hills, which cometh my help.
Yes.
And Father God, I ask you to watch over us as we go to our homes, continue to be with Pastor and his wife and the family and the ones that couldn't be here today. And let us all realize, no matter what the circumstance, Jesus Christ is still Lord.
Yes.
Amen and amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So you are dismissed.